try to imagine all life as you know it stopping instantaneously and every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light.
Total photonic reversal.
Photonic reversal.
Photonic reversal with your host, Conan Neutron. Broadcasting from a secret underground lair in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
A gigantic middle finger to everything that is rotten about music, rock and roll, and corporate power.
The thing is, though, if you don't laugh, you're going to go on a killing spree to sharpen nails.
Confidence of a hero or a fool, I wasn't exactly certain which.
Could not be more professional.
It means something.
And they got away.
You know, that's my take. What's yours?
Protonic reversal.
That's like a science thing, right?
Indeed. It is a science thing. It is a science place. It is a scientific fact that we are all up in your face. It is time for the one, the only Protonic Reversal. Welcome to it. Special guest tonight, the legendary Mike Hard, most known for the amazing God Bullies, if you're familiar. And if you're not familiar, you're going to be like, who? But if you are familiar, wow. Yeah, what a band. What an amazing band. And also Thrall, the underrated Thrall. They Never Sleep. Plenty of Mike Hardisms. Mike Hardisms? Mike Hard. Plenty of Mike Hard to go around. Really excited about this. This is, I'd like to thank Johnny for hooking this up, who's a listener to the show. And he basically said, do you want Mike Hard on the show? And I said, fuck yes, I do. When can we make that happen? So yeah, mostly God Bullies, but if you like Brainsaw, They Never Sleep, Thrall, et cetera. Amazing dude. One of the great front people of all time. For real. So if it's your first time joining the show, the name of the show is Conan Neutron's Protonic Reversal. This is a live show / podcast. ProtonicReversal.com for the archives. Thanks for listening to it. This is the... How many episodes have I done? 231, something like that. This is 231. Okay, cool. So this is episode 231 of this show. The archives are always free. Any place you get your podcast, on YouTube, all that stuff. Patreon.com/ProtonicReversal, that supports the show. And if you give it at the dollar a month level, you get the episodes sooner rather than later. What does that mean? You get them pretty much immediately after the live show. Thank you so much for tuning in. And let's talk to the legendary Mr. Mike Hard.
And we are live now with the one and only, the legendary, the awesome Mr. Mike Hard of God Bullies. Mike, welcome. Welcome to the show, man. This is great. So great to have you.
Thank you. Oh, man. Thank you very much. Thank you. It's great to be here. And it's great for you to remember us rock and rollers.
Yeah. I mean, it's something where we were sort of bemoaning the technology, not bemoaning necessarily, but talking about the challenges of technology and the things that one must know in this day and age to just be keep up with the general ethos of life. But I think what's interesting to me is that I've been enjoying seeing like a new generation of rockers kind of go back and find stuff like God Bullies and be like, wow, this is amazing. Like, you know, this is so, you know, confrontational and so, you know, like, vital in a way. And like, this is like years later, like with a completely different context, but finding something of value there.
Yeah, it's really great. It's I do the same thing now with like old music and going to the garage sales and estate sales and Salvation Armies, and you find this album and you're like, who the heck were these guys? Oh my gosh, this is like, Johnny and I were just listening to these bands that before we came on, that like Blind, Daylight and just Fort Mudge Memorial from the 70s. Just these great, great, great bands that you find them, just like you said, and it lives on. But if you can find a God Bully album at the Salvation Army, I think it'll be a great find, and you'll enjoy the music.
It's funny you mention that, because I always
I think our music lives on too. I listen to it now, and I still think it.
Yeah. So it's interesting to me, because when you think about like the Salvation Army, I always think about it being kind of like a seed of deviancy, right? That somebody can just find like, what's this? You know, this is something crazy. This isn't like the best of disco. This is something completely different. And that is something that like just saying that kind of paints like a word picture in my mind of finding some of my favorite bands that way, of just like, this looks interesting. What is this all about? And I wonder, I mean, obviously the way.
Yeah, it's just fantastic.
Yeah, I think that holds across all different kinds of generations. It's weird to me that not having that physical tactile experience of like going to a place and being like, oh, what's this all about? This looks, you know, a freaking, you know, Sir Lord Baltimore. What's that? You know, that's a weird name.
Oh, that's a great album. I have that. It's a great album. I have it. It's fantastic.
It is.
Heavy metal, early 70s rock and roll right there. Sir Lord Baltimore. Yeah.
That's my favorite example.
Crashing into the rocks.
Yeah, it's so good, and you're like, I can't.
They're everywhere.
Yeah, like the idea is like, I can't wait to hear what this is all about. Like this is awesome. So I guess let's start with the fact. Go ahead, Mike.
Sorry. Right, and no one's telling you to buy it.
Right, you're just looking for it on.
I was just saying, no one's telling you to buy it. No one's like saying, check this out or anything. It's just. Yeah, you just found it, right? Yeah, and you discover something, so it's beautiful.
So the thing that kind
of
gets
a lot of my music.
Yeah. So was that something where were you coming from a kind of a more rock background, like a classic rock background? Like, what was your beginning to starting up with God Bullies and starting up with, you know, the rock and roll life, such as it is? Like, what was your pathway in?
Well, it's crazy. I moved to Kalamazoo after I got out of the Navy and started going to Western Michigan on the GI Bill. And that's where I met David at Western Michigan. And there's just, you know, at the time it's like 1981, 1982. Then, you know, everyone's going to college, and that's kind of how it started, you know, just to open up for the bigger bands that would come to town. I'm sure it's the way you've heard with a lot of bands like us. You know, we love the music so much, and we, you know, maybe didn't want to pay to get in, or maybe wanted two free beers a night, you know, whatever. But we just started playing in front of, you know, our favorite bands that would come to there. Everyone's pretty much self-taught. And thanks to Tom Hazelmeyer, it got a lot bigger than Kalamazoo.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost the test kitchen of like American college town. And I mean that as a compliment, but in a way that like there's a certain kind of, there might be like amazing bands that are there, but they're not necessarily going to be known throughout, because it's mostly people like either in reaction to what's going on or just kind of making their own thing because they don't have the same thing that you would have in like a big city scene or something. You wouldn't have that influence or that pressure even. That's my take on it anyway. How do you feel that's accurate?
Well, yeah, you have a lot of young kids. Well, for a lot of people, it's their first time away from home, and they're young kids, and they came to the college from smaller towns throughout all of Michigan or from Detroit and got into these small little enclaves and created their own little scene, more so than like in a big city where, you know, it was a whole different scene in a big city compared to like a town where a lot of young people are going and in that scene at once. You kind of create your own scene in a small town. We would go to Detroit and Chicago, it'd be totally different from, you know, Kalamazoo and Battle Creek and these other kind of. We'd always do our best shows with you know, be in Dubuque or Minneapolis or Milwaukee or Madison, Wisconsin. I mean, that's where our most notorious shows were always took place. New York and LA, you know, a whole different scene. We didn't, we played there and we had people there, but not like what we would draw, especially in Texas. Oh my God. Texas loved themselves some God Bullies.
Well, and that's, it's interesting to me because when God Bullies first came to my attention, it was prefaced by just a paragraph of statements is like, this band is so crazy. They're so wild live. They're so like, and I was like, okay, cool. And you kind of take all that with a grain of salt, right? You're like, yeah, okay, cool. They're crazy. I'm sure. Right. Fine. And then I was like, oh no, this is intense.
Right.
This is some intense stuff. And it's something where was that an outgrowth naturally of what you guys were doing musically? Did you have any kind of mindset of, hey, these guys are about here and we're going to take it there. Like, was that preconceived or did it come naturally?
Oh no. I think rock and roll is intense. And when you feel it and it's in your soul, it really, really comes out. And we were an intense band because, you know, the environment we lived in is really intense. And especially in the Midwest, I started wearing the suit and tie all the time as a representation of like this frustrated middle-class working guy that finally he's been led astray his whole life. And when you see that light and you're illuminated, it's a really intense feeling. And I try to go through that gradual progression in a show where I go and you're in a suit and tie and you look like all these other motherfuckers in the suit and tie. But you eventually see this man go totally mad when he's confronted with the reality. Musicians I had those moments intense.
Yeah.
Great band most of the time to play with. So.
Well, and it came across so powerfully, and it's something where, if you recall the, that movie that came out in the 90s with Michael Douglas, Falling Down. Like the thing, I was like, oh, it's like a God Bullies thing, like this, to a certain degree.
Yeah, that's a good comparison as far as like that movie, what that guy was saying, because he went through the steps. And, you know, coming from the Midwest, it's the Bible Belt, right? So, you know, we've been led astray ever since youth. You know, you're not born to hate. You know, it's not you're not born with that feeling. So it's taught to you. And your whole life, you know, you feel like you believed in everything you're taught, but then you start college town, start reading other things and seeing other things and experiencing other things, and you realize you've been lied to your whole life.
Right.
And that's intense if you really think about it. It's like everything you believed and thought you believed in is totally a lie, you know? And that betrayal is, that's intense. And trying to show an audience that emotion or that feeling, like, you know, I was taught to hate, you know, I was taught to believe it, that someone died for me to make, you know, that guilt that's associated with that, you know, it's intense. So we try to get that out in front of people, this whole like awakening thing, like being saved or being, you know, born again, you know, of all of a sudden, wow, I'm enlightened. I see the light now. I don't hate women. I don't hate black people. It's once you get through that and see that light, I mean, look what we're going through right now. You know, with I think it's exactly what we were talking about, you know, 20 years ago.
Yeah, sadly, it's, you know, the only thing that's different is that there's these tools for connection now that show it to us in different ways, but everything's much more magnified. And I think that's...
Oh, I'd hate to say I told you so, but the last song we did for Tom, for Amphetamine Reptile, we did the reunion in 2010 or 11. And last we did was called Wake Up. And right. It's the chorus in it is like, how many lies does it take to make you believe? When are you going to open your eyes and wake up? You got to wake up from the dream. And you just look at what's happening. These people believe this huge lie. And, you know, we're warning people about it. can you imagine, like, these people did this to our capital because of a lie?
Yeah, exactly.
From, con man, from a snake oil salesman, you know. It's just crazy to believe that they would believe in a lie. They must feel really, really bad right now. Especially with their FBI having all their fucking pictures.
Well, yeah, exactly. And that's something where, like, hey, maybe taking a bunch of selfies wasn't necessarily, like, the move. That maybe that wasn't the best thing to be
but
doing.
That's all they know. They don't know the best thing to do. That's all they know. So they're just doing what they know. And best yet, yeah, you see pictures that they have them just coming out of the building. Now they have names or the faces to attach the names to. They did it. They did the government a huge favor.
Yeah, absolutely.
On purpose. Yeah.
It's real easy to find them. Yeah, exactly.
yeah. I mean, yeah, I believe there's good conspiracies to believe in, like, you know, the government dumping dope on ghettos and LSD on college campuses. There's great conspiracies that you can really believe in. But the stuff they're teaching these kids now, I mean, you can't even write a book about it. It's so, so terrible.
Yeah, I was talking about, I can't remember who I was talking about with, but I was talking about how, like, conspiracy theories used to be fun, like Art Bell and stuff, you know, like oh, check it out. Check out this guy's all about.
Oh, Art Bell. Yeah, you know, being on tour, we used to listen to Art Bell all night long because, you know, he'd play, like, Minneapolis and have to drive to Seattle and be there the next day.
Sure.
And we'd listen to Art Bell. He was a king, yeah. But that's good UFO flying saucer, you know. And but this stuff has been around, like David Icke with the lizard people. I mean, it's been around so long. To see it popularized is just amazing. But then you look at how it was and the tool it's used for. It's how it's been turned around into popular culture to actually be true. Some of it, you know, the lizard people.
Maybe less so, maybe, yeah.
You can go out on a limb with that a little bit, maybe. But.
Well, yeah, there's an Arnis Reptoid that really lays into it. And it's something where, you know, he like loves the conspiracy and loves the feelings behind it and like the people behind it, but, you know, is not a believer of these conspiracies. And he gets some pretty weird email. Let's put it that way. but like he dresses like a reptilian alien. And it's like this one guy on the drums and everything's sequenced. And it's amazing, but it's also like, yeah, I don't want to read your fan mail, man. Sure. It's pretty rough. Well, and it occurs to me also that God bullies.
Yeah, they might be out there. Who knows? We were trying to think the other day where QAnon came from.
Yeah, but I mean,
you know, who started?
Right. Who actually started QAnon? Like, who started where did it? That come from? Yeah.
Do you know? Do you have any idea?
I think it's like either like a kid in New Jersey. Like in his basement or like an unemployed dude, I think.
It's funny. I have friends that called me right away because, you know, some of my songs and things like that kind of can, you know, go with that kind of some conspiracy theories type stuff. And I'm like, where did you get this garbage? You know, I went through the whole thing and I just couldn't believe it's like, and they believed it. You know, I think actually Mike Corso, the Godbilly bass player, is a huge QAnon guy. Which it's like, Mike, didn't you listen to any of our songs? You know, Jesus Christ. But I think it's National Enquirer. I really do. I think they're
like Bat Boy and all that.
Yeah. It's like, I think when we find this all out, I think at the end we're going to find out that QAnon is the National Enquirer on Facebook and on the internet. I think that's my tip to you. It's just, well, it looks like something you'd read at the tabloid going at the cash register, you know, checking out and grab the, Bat Boy eats alien eggs or. You know, some strange headline, but look at it. I mean, if you look at it, someone's got to be with money behind it.
Well, yeah, but then it's also like, well, what are they serving? Like, what are they hoping to get out of it?
Well, we already seen what they gained about it. Look what, look at our capital. I mean, the lie, it's, when you go into it, it's just hilarious. Like John F. Kennedy's still alive and goes to Trump rallies and it's true.
I think it's just small point of clarification. I believe it's meant to be JFK Jr. But
that's who it is.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, we know what we're talking about. Yeah. He didn't die in a plane crash. And oh my God. Yeah. It's, I think it's National Enquirer behind the whole thing because it's just so slighted towards Trump. And that guy's a really good friend of Trump. They're buddies.
Well, and so there's a few things to kind of pick up on there. But one thing I thought was really fantastic with Godbelly's stuff is there's a good amount of critical thinking with the music and the songs. Like kind of like put through your own prism, so to speak. But there is that kind of initial, like if you walked into that band without any context or without having a friend kind of tell you what was up or what was going on, it's just this almost like scary presentation, Rick. What's going on? Like what is this? Like, is this like what are these guys all about? And it just occurs to me that there's so little in life like that, especially now. Like this, the mystery in life for the most part is taken out. But you know, even looking back at the footage, like what made it into the Color of Noise documentary, and like looking back at that footage and be like, wow, yeah, if you saw this like today, it would still kind of be unnerving in a way, in a good way, in a way that kind of makes you think about your surroundings and makes you think about like what it means to be at a rock show or whatever. I mean, were you trying to like confuse, baffle, or annoy the Rubes, or was it something that just kind of happened naturally with all that?
Whatever.
Mike, still there?
From the inside, it comes out. Like that, we're from the Midwest. We've been breaking up a little bit, but can you hear me?
I can hear you. Yeah, you're great.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yeah, you're
okay. No, I'm just saying, it really comes from being grown up in the Midwest and just seeing what people go through to live, you know, and putting the shoe on the other foot. We had so many different rock and roll influences because being from Detroit, from Iggy Pop to MC5, and I mean, even Captain Beefheart. I mean, sure. And we had some trance stuff that we do with our drummer because we could get some good trance music going. But it was all supposed to be an out-of-your-body experience, getting outside of your shoes and putting it on someone else's feet, or getting outside of your body and being able to look at yourself a little bit. I mean, I couldn't believe – like for one thing, when Tom Hazelmeyer started putting out our stuff, I really didn't think we were like a label for him, but I was just so glad that he did it because, you know, Hayes is known for the power trio, the really heavy, heavy grinding stuff. And when he put out the God Bullies, I was just like amazed that he did that. And thankful too. And then we found out we were a lot alike. We all love guns. Tom was an ex-Marine. I was in the Navy. And yeah. So it was just a different relationship, and you know, touring with the Cows and a lot of the other bands. I mean, we fit in really well with the Cows. Matter of fact, I think if I think of bands that I like the most and still like the most, and like you could play anytime or put the record on right now, like we were talking about the earlier records from the 70s.
Yeah, sure.
The Cows are the band that you can constantly play and still, you know, feel what they're doing. But we toured a lot with them, and I thought that was a great 1-2 punch, Shannon and me on tour on the same stage together.
Well, I mean, yeah, you get two very powerful, intelligent front people kind of doing something that is forcing people to be in the moment. And even though the results are maybe not even remotely close, or like not necessarily close afield to be in whatever the genre category would be in the bin in the record store, you both have like a transgressive kind of performance that makes people think about where they're at. And I think that that's incredibly valuable. And that's not something that you see most bands try to do, because I'm not necessarily certain if that gets you fame and riches necessarily.
At that time, it's totally about living in the now, you know, feeling the moment. And if you start thinking about riches or anything else, if I was in this for money, I'd have quit a long time ago. It's really, like you said earlier, it's about the now. It's living in the now. And I think that's the best way you could describe a Cow show or a Godbelly show is we're going to make you feel alive and in the room with us for this few moments we have together tonight. And man, those 45 minutes you have with the crowd or whatever, however long, those are your minutes with those people. And you want to impress them. You want to make them feel like we're all the same people. We have the same feelings. We have the same emotions. But we, basically, we've been lied to, and they've been misconstrued, and they're pointed to opposite directions. So those few moments we have together, it's all about. That's living in the now. And when you're touring and you're playing it for money, you're not playing it for free beer. Moment you have on stage that night, I couldn't believe how long the cows. I couldn't do it. It was. They say the definition of insanity is when you keep doing the same thing over again and expect different results. That's what it kind of got to be. So
totally, yeah.
More power to Shannon in Heroin Sheiks and. Just being able to keep doing it for that many years, I didn't have it in me. It's grinding. But I love making music.
Yeah,
and like
I mean,
after God Bullies, you know, I put out Thrall and the Brain
Thrall, right?
And They Never Sleep, and yeah, in some really other good music, but. You know, never really the distribution. Jello Biafra put out a couple of Thrall records. And he put out a God Bully record as well.
He put out that last one, if I remember correctly. Yeah, so Kill the
that
King.
That was
kind of right?
Cool.
Yeah.
Working with Jello.
Yeah, Jello's a
right. Yeah, yeah. That album I really like a lot.
Yeah, that's got some. And I kind of wanted to go through the records, all of them. I tend to kind of do it sequentially because I think that's kind of a cool way to do it. Would you mind doing that? Just kind of telling me like maybe a little bit of the thoughts behind each of the records and you know, if you have any interesting stories or experiences that like tie with it, or just think of like what the band was doing around that time. You into that? All right.
Yeah. Like the first
Plastic
record
Eye.
Was yeah. Mama
Woo. Oh yeah.
And
the first one on AMRAP.
Plastic Eye was a second that came out right after that.
My bad. Sorry.
Right. And Plastic Eye came out after AMRAP. It came out because it actually came out in Germany on a written some on a different label. But yeah. And so, Mama Woo came out and there's a song on it called Red Blood.
Okay.
Yeah. It was from a play that we did that we met this weird German guy from this little theater in Kalamazoo. And we used to play there and he saw us live and he wanted to do this play, and we never heard of this George Buchner guy or who Wojciech was. So we got the script, we read it, and it turns out this George Buchner was like the Kurt Cobain of Germany in 1849. He did three plays and, you know, had, you know, died very young, I think more of a disease. But so we start doing this play, and that song Red Blood is from that play. And like I said, it's the murder scene after he kills Marine. He comes back to town, he's got blood on his hands and he's got a knife, and he's, you know, saying it wasn't me, you know. Yeah. So it's that was like the first album, and Hayes put that out. And then Plastic Guy came out, which was from live at some of it was live at the Cabaret Metro in Chicago. The next record, Dog Show. I don't know. We get to we did all those records. David recorded them on 8-track.
Interesting. So you have a limited amount of space to work with when you're doing it through 8-track, right? So.
Oh right, yeah. You dump the drums. You do all the drums, and you dump them down to a mix, and then you start doing the individual tracks. And David was the master of the 8-track on those first two records. I think he did the Cows second album at about the same time we did Dog Show.
Right. That would track. That's around the same time. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So David was just around the 8-track. He was just fantastic. And so Dog Show, I really like a lot. It has Let's Go to Hell on it, which was which, you know, a perfect song for the God Bullies. has a great rock and roll beat. And,
well, you got like, and you got songs like Do It Again, which is sort of like almost like 70s kind of like, you know, strutting. I mean, I hesitate to say like Aerosmith or something, but like big rock kind of feel like as through your guys' lens.
Right. And, yeah. Hazelmeyer loved that lyric. It feels good to the very last drop.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I mean, We're a different band for AMRAP, man.
Yeah, and there's more like, you know, almost like space psychedelic stuff going on there. Kind of like I think of sort of classic, you know, Butthole Surfers, like when they would just, you know, have a perfectly nice song and then, you know, kind of go someplace batshit crazy with it. Like that same sort of ethos, but like put through your own meat grinder,
right,
if you will.
Well, and with Dog Show, it's a little bit more rock, and it doesn't quite – it does have I'm Invisible on it, which is a really, really good song. But the first album was with Tommy Shannon instead of David Livingstone. Most of that stuff was written with Tommy Shannon, and he plays maybe a little bit of that, but David pretty much plays all the guitars on it. And Tommy Shannon came back to play all the main guitar on Kill the King. So that's why with the first album, Mama Woom Woom, it's a little bit more psychedelic, maybe. And then the third album, War on Everybody, was done with Tony from The Cows, plays drums on that. And that was recorded up in Minneapolis in David's apartment on the 8-track. And Eric Paulson plays bass on that, who was from some bands in Kalamazoo. And basically, Mike and... at that time, Mike and Adam weren't with the band anymore because it's just so hard to tour and keep a band going and different responsibilities. And David and I still wanted to do it. And Tony just got back from that the Cows tour. And I don't know, that was after Shannon broke both his arms. And that was a really tough tour for the Cows.
Yeah, that's...
That was really... we were on tour with them. We played the CMJ, and we were actually at CBGB's when Shannon came back with both of his arms broken, riding on the back of a motorcycle.
Jesus Christ.
Like 4 a.m.
leave it to Shannon Selberg, I swear.
Yeah, it's like, Shannon, you better go to the hospital. That doesn't look too good, man. It was, oh my gosh. So that must have been a hell tour.
Well, and that's War on Everybody. There's a great line, unfortunately, relatively evergreen. With that, you know, the color of blood is the color of war. The color of war is the color of money.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's.
What year did that come out? That was.
I know it. I...
91, right?
Yeah. The color of blood is the color of war. The color of war is the color of money. Piggy, 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 piggy. That's when it's so crazy because, you know, people didn't riot on the Capitol because, you know, all the wealth in the country is controlled by 96% of the people, or they totally fucked up the COVID thing and you've lost 500,000 people or your job or you can't pay your rent. No, you know what I mean? It's like, that's how blind we are and how misled we are. They went up there and did that shit over a lie. So yeah, when you think about back then, this is what we were saying. It hasn't changed much, or else we're fucking Nostradamus. And I have to think it's the other way around.
It'd be nice to take credit, but...
Yeah, but it hasn't changed. It hasn't changed much, you know, or it's gotten worse. But the people in power are the people in power, and it's a constant battle. And people just, God dang, I don't know if it's the dummy down, you know, like the dummy down they're doing with people, so they're just so stupid they can't make decisions for themselves. But it's happening, and it's getting worse. You know, if you can imagine being worse than like Ronald Reagan and the Bush thing and the Gulf Wars and David Koresh and Ruby Ridge and all that stuff that went on when we were writing that stuff, you know.
I mean, I even think back to like
Oklahoma City bombing.
No, totally. Yeah, it reminds me of when our biggest problem was like the Patriot Act, right? Where it's like, oh no, they're taking, you know, they're going to be up in everyone's business. It's like, yeah, now this is an assumed thing. It's just sort of everybody's
assumed,
okay.
Yeah. Fine, yeah, everybody's right. Okay, fine. Yeah, track me and listen into my conversations. You know, it's taken for granted. Maybe the younger kids don't care about it as much. I don't know.
Well, they haven't grown up with anything else. Some of them, so you know, they don't even remember a time that wasn't the case. But so just getting back,
right?
that's a deep hole we can go down.
Yeah,
trust me.
Right. Yeah. So war on everybody.
War on everybody. Yeah. So you in the you got that one at the end. The dawn. It's like the Dawn of the Dead sample.
Oh right. Yeah. Yeah. David David did that pretty much without me. I mean, I think I might have some shouting somewhere on it somewhere, but that was all done up in Minneapolis with David, Tony, and Eric. But really nice, yeah. Dawn of the Dead on that. But we've always had some great samples.
Yeah, I was going to say, but used in such a way that it wasn't like necessarily, you know, the centerpiece of the song, but like something like used as like a garnishment. Garnishment? Right. Garnish. A garnish. Garnishment is when sometimes your wages. Garnish, right. We'll say. So so when you're talking about War and Everybody, like talk about, all right, so 91. There's a lot going on around 91. There's a lot happening. If you're not aware, Mike, where there's a lot happening that year.
Yeah. I might not know the details so well, but it was written at a time where there's a lot of turmoil and I think the beginning of this whole movement we're seeing right now is kind of like started gradually around the early 90s, like what we're seeing what we're seeing with the takeover of the media and the mind. It's just, I think that's when it first started, because at that time we were just starting getting into the computer age, if I remember right. Computers weren't fully on your desk or on your phone or anything. So we're not really in the information age yet. But you could see how it was all lining up, you know.
Did you ever, there was that movie, I think it was 95, Hackers, where I actually happened to like accidentally sort of rewatch part of it recently. And it occurred to me how much of it was revolved around like payphones and they recorded the tones. And it's like, wow, like explain what a payphone is now. Like, good luck trying to figure that out.
Or a beeper, right?
Right, exactly. But by the same token, the inherent power dynamics between the characters and, you know, what they're attempting to accomplish, the adversaries, the heavies, if you will, within that movie, you know, it's not hard to like draw a parallel between like, wow, that was like 25 years ago, but kind of the same thing's going on, really. It's just that, like, you know, the special effects look much better and there's not so much payphone involvement, really.
The human mind is the human mind, right? I mean, it's a tool for some people, but yeah, it's a magical device for if you know how to use it right. And it's kind of been turned into a tool. But, you know, 91, you know, I look at when that record came out, and there's like the song Ordinary Man. It's like, I'm just an ordinary man, you know. But, you know, I have this psychosis going, you know, and it's like he's saying, I'm having the worst time of my life, so I'm going to go on and take it out on someone else,
right?
And I mean, that's what you started seeing, you know, around 91, where people this kind of narcissism start creeping in, that's really come into full blown right about with this age.
Well, and with your dynamic, you know, life. We made the, I guess I'm making movie illusions now. It's like all I'm doing, but like Falling Down. But I think also about like the classic, like the preacher character, I think Tom Waits said it eloquently with the preacher with a gun in his hand, like aspect. And that's always kind of the vibe that I got off of what you're doing to the Godbillies. And it was sort of like, I don't necessarily understand what's being thrown down right now, but I'm goddamn right going to listen.
Well, well, you know, I think I was more the preacher with the child in his hand than the gun. And
right.
And we did like the baby doll thing as that type of symbolism. It was like, here's this mad guy holding a baby. You know, what is he going to drop it?
Yeah, what's going to happen?
Is he going to kiss it? I mean, what is he going to do? Is he going to nurture it? And so, you know, I mean, our shows used to be like, we would have pornography all over the stage and baby dolls and flowers that we snuck into a cemetery and stole the plastic flowers off the heap in the back, and American flags everywhere, crosses. Right. Crosses, and we try to wreck it, destroy it all by the end of the night, to take these icons and just totally destroy them. And, you know, hopefully the baby made it through the night without its body parts being torn off by the crowd.
Which is so interesting, because it's sort of like, yeah, that action's not being done by the band, but it's being done by like your reaction to what is happening.
I give the audience the baby like it's my child, and I hand it to them, and they start just tearing on it and ripping it apart. You know, it's like, hold it. No, hold it to your nipple, you know.
That's kind of one of the things that, you know, there being this sort of a cracked element of you know, a cracked mirror towards society, right? Like that, like, you know, it's like, okay, we're going to present this image, these images, these visuals to you along with the music presented in this manner, and how you react to it is just as much a part of the show as anything else, which sounds like at the elementary level, like obvious, but
sure.
But it's not, right? Is what I'm trying to say.
Oh man, where's the place in Berkeley? It's that everyone played
Gilman
something Street.
Oh, Gilman, gosh. Street, 94 Gilman.
Anyway, Gilman Street. Yeah, so we played Gilman Street one time. There you go. So we played Gilman Street, and you know how like Berkeley is. We bring out the American flag. It's like maybe I'm wearing it as a diaper or something, but it starts to eventually get set on fire, of course, right? So
as one does, yeah.
At Gilman Street, one side of the audience is lighting the flag on fire, and the other side is putting it out with, you know, like, no, it's American flag. It's, you know, the hippie type crowd from Berkeley are lighting it on fire. So here's a symbol being representing two different things to two different people, and right. Eventually I had to take the flag away from them. They weren't being nice to each other. It was terrible.
Right.
Take the toy away.
Oh God, is that ever an analog for American politics, huh?
But yeah, you know, it's just like you said, it is what it is. It's symbols are symbols to different people, and they represent different things. And we're all about destroying all icons, destroying all symbols, and becoming a human again. And so that was the process of a show, was coming out all structured in a suit and tie with a structure all around you, holding a Bible and all this structure, and then taking it all away, removing it, you know. And becoming naked.
Did you ever have any right? And with the record, did you ever have any concerns towards, you know, like when you have vocals affected, like you're not necessarily getting like anyone that's like willing to like listen to the lyrics and want to like find out more about it, they're gonna listen intently and find it, but it doesn't make it as easy to get a message out. Necessarily, it makes it more like not an instrument necessarily, but like a part of like the greater whole. Right. Did you ever have any thoughts towards that?
Well, I did start putting lyrics on my Thrall records and the last God Bullies because of that problem with like the words, you know, and you know, rock and roll is rock and roll. I when I hear it, I know exactly what I'm saying, so I think everyone else can. So.
Right, but people are like, you know, oh, there's a cool guitar riff. There's this is happening over there, and they focus on different things. And what I've personally found is people tend to assume it's something far more mundane and mediocre than what it actually is.
That's life. that's life. Yeah.
But the reason why I ask is because what you're singing about and what you were addressing was like, you know, literate, like good turns of phrases, like good, like, you know, oh wow, that's thoughtful. That's interesting. You know, I dreamt I was at your funeral. I stood in line just to see you dead.
Yeah, that's a great song. And that song couldn't have been done without Tony and Eric. But yeah, that song. Yeah, I stood in line just to see you dead. I mean, that's what you do when you go to a funeral. You stand in line, and you. and you're right. It's mundane, right? It is. But
yeah,
it's kind of saying like that. It comes a little bit more creepier and mysterious. But and then someone at the funeral, like the old fart rolls over on you. You know, I mean, he's talking. He's saying stuff that's not that, you know, they hire the priest for the moment and he's got like 10 funerals to do that day. So, I mean, you're the first or second or third one.
Right.
And you don't know how sincere it is or if you're talking about the person he actually knows or just saying a few good words before you move on to the next level. But,
just
yeah.
Knocking him out and thinking about what's for lunch. Exactly.
Yeah. Next. Yeah.
like the world's saddest assembly line. But I mean, that said, you know, it's a routine like any other,
right.
I suppose, you know.
Right.
Cool.
Right. Right.
You know, we kind of glossed a little past it. But the what did the different players in the band bring to it? Because you're coming at it from perspective of like you're the lightning rod. Like you're the, you know, you're the focus point for a lot of people, but what's happening with the band is pretty vital, and changing any aspect of it is going to change the chemistry. Like, chemistry is an overutilized term, but I'm literally thinking of chemistry, like mixing different chemicals together.
Right, right. Well, as a singer, and I'm not a musician, so I would write with the music I would get, you know, right. and what we'd get from the band. And it's all who could work together the best. And you know, musicians are very dysfunctional. I hate to say it, probably more, I don't know, singers are too. I mean, but trying to get four guys to do anything together, or five guys, even when you add that fifth variable, oh my God, it is so hard, you know, to get anyone to agree or do anything. So, yeah, the dynamics are created out of just working together and jamming and getting a feel for each other. And, you know, thank God I've had musicians that believe in the words I'm saying. Because that's really important. If the musicians don't believe in what you're saying as a singer, or don't stand behind it. I mean, when David Livingstone recites some lyrics I have in a song, I'm just like totally, oh my God, he understands, you know? And it makes me really, really happy that he stands behind what I'm saying as a singer and as a front man. Because I can't just go up there and sing about cars and girls and, you know.
Well, I mean, it would be disingenuous, right? It wouldn't be where you're coming at. And it's, I mean, I think you could say a lot of things about God Bullies, but inauthentic would definitely not be one of them. You know, it's again, coming at it without any context whatsoever is almost disarming at first. You're like, what's going on with this? But.
Oh, I can imagine when you put on Act of Desire on, and you know, you have Jack Van Empe, you know, going on there, you know, it's the beat of the drums, louder and faster, faster and louder, you know, and Adam's just going to it on with his tribal drum beat. That's the first song. I think, it sets a good kind of trance for the rest of the record on Mama Woom Woom.
Yeah, that reminds me almost, I don't know if it was anything it was in mind or not, but like Flowers of Romance with P.I.L., where it's just it's like, wow, it's interesting that there's like so little happening. Like
I know, and I loved it. And Act of Desire, I just sampled with David, sampled it back in the day with a sampler in like 1985 or 87. And I just said Act of Desire, and we just kept hitting a button, you know?
Yeah.
But then we have other stuff where my lyrics are all the way through it, and it's a full song. I'm Invisible is another one kind of that was on I'm Invisible is on Dog Show. And once again, very simple lyrics. I am invisible. You can see through me. You know, all you see is yourself. I am invisible.
But simple lyrics, but in the delivery and execution, it's almost like the are you familiar with the. It's like an acting exercise where you're given a word and you have to say the same word back and forth to each other in different ways and present your emotions and have a conversation using the same word. If you're familiar with this.
I don't know.
Okay. It's okay. Not to, but it's sort of like you get two actors and you say, okay, your word is marmalade. And somebody's like, marmalade, marmalade. Marmalade, you know, they say
okay,
things
all right,
in a different way to evoke different emotions. And I guess where I'm, and believe me, I have a place I'm going with this. What I think about is in terms of, you know, like I felt like you did some stuff with that where instead of being like heady and loquacious and like here's 16 pages worth of lyrics, you know, not that there were lyrics on those records, it's almost like. Think of, you know, the Stooges with No Fun. It's very clear, like, right. You know, by the inflection, what is meant, like the emotion, and it gets across in the inflection. And I guess where I'm going at with that is being, you know, knowing as you advance and as the band continued to play and evolve and change, did you find that you were able to dig down deeper in different ways? And what kind of stuff did you find people responded to or that worked for you to kind of push yourself to do different stuff, but also not necessarily have different be more per se.
Well, once again, as a front man, probably even more than a singer, I've always relied on the musician to bring the material with them. And they know what I'm writing my songs about and what my lyrics are. So they know that like the mood they want to create with their music. And then with that music, I see the mood that they're trying to create. And I also try to create a song that's around that mood of that song. So like when I get a song like I Am Invisible and it's more or less a jam through the whole thing, I don't want to get too complex. You know, I don't, I the story can be very, very simple because it's built around the music. Where a song like I Like It Like That, or which, or like you were saying earlier, what was the song? Let's Do It Again. That's more of like a rock. What they gave me, like you said, is a rock and roll beat. Let's do it. Do, 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 do. So I want a rock and roll song with that. So yeah, let's do it again. You know, I stood up, I fell down. You know, let's do it again. And so that's kind of the mood that they created. It's a great rocker. So then it has more like rock and roll lyrics to it. If you listen to like Ordinary Man. Starts out with a guitar solo, and then it's got that pace to it, that really nervous pace to it. So I'm this really nervous guy that's, you know, he's going to go down to the adult video arcade during my lunch hour, you know.
Right, like so it's almost like the feel of the music kind of incites the lyrics and the story that's being told, the allegory that.
I mean, yeah, I could be something else about being that nervous guy at lunch that no one understands. He has no friends and no one wants to talk to him, and the only free time he has is his lunch hour, you know. But you know, but at the time that I was around a lot of women that were working in like peep shows and strip shows, and that's what. So they're telling me this stuff, you know. Then I'm hanging around with them. You're like, "Oh my God, are you serious? You did what? Oh, you got to watch. Oh my, oh, I don't know how you could do that job, you know." And so, you know, once again, it's influenced by the community and the people I'm hanging around with. And Ordinary Man's a very scary man, you know. He's very, very scary. He's yelling "War on everybody!" at the end. War on, you know, war on peace, war on crime, war on everybody all the time. War on everybody. You know, so at the beginning of the song, you know, no one understands him, but at the end of the song, you understand him.
Well, it's like the, you know, the idea that, you know, everyone contains multitudes. What is that, Whitman? Like, is that I can't remember who said that, but you know, it's the idea that people aren't just one thing. People aren't just you know, caricature or you know, like I guess people today would say a non-player character. That's become a phrase that people talk about a lot now. But it's interesting that to me that so much of what you wrote about, like, you know, whether it was, you know, revelatory, celebratory, or, you know, on the darker side, it was, you know, talking about not even just the duality of man, but the multi-dimensional aspects of what made people who and what they were searching for and doing. And it's something that like a lot of people that are like front men and, like, you know, as I've often said, like the lightning rods of jackassery wouldn't necessarily go for it that way, you know.
Well, you know, on War on Everybody, there's a song called "Looking." What are you looking for? And that's exactly what it is right there. It's like, what are you looking for? You know, I mean, that's a dealing with exactly what you're just talking about. You know, dealing with as being a singer in a rock and roll band. It's like, you come to me to be your savior, or you think I'm anything more than what you are? I'm just, you know, I'm just revealing myself to you, and that's about as simple as it is. I'm not a savior. I'm not, you know, what are you looking for? You know, it's it talks about just being led astray your whole life, and coming back, and then coming to a person like me, and like, I'm not the answer. I'm just the vehicle.
Right.
You know.
Exactly. You're the delivery system, if you will.
Yeah, there you go. All right.
You know, we talked a bit about the present, like the live presentation, and kind of alluded to the almost like preacher aspect of it, but also just the you know, front man as the plight of the common man and the duality within. But it occurs to me, first of all, that's a very pretentious sentence. Secondly, it also occurs to me that you know, there's a rich tradition of, you know, if you're going to be the singer, if you're the person singing, like, you better bring the show.
Right.
And when you were thinking about what you wanted to do, did you have anything in mind? Did you have any other artists that you're like, wow, that's really cool. That's an interesting presentation. you know, I'm going to steal that, or I'm going to do my version of that, or something along those lines. I mean, I think anybody with a forceful presence, no matter what, you're always going to get an Iggy. Why wouldn't you?
Right, and I think anybody that's a front man is going to get an Iggy, you know, thing, because Iggy's the man. I mean, Iggy's the front man of front men. So
He's the greatest of all time. I mean, okay to be compared to geniuses, right?
Yeah, but still, you know, I'm 6'3", and he's only 5'1".
Well, and that's the thing. You cut a much more imposing presence, and like right. I would say, in the same reign as Eugene Robinson for Moxbow, that it's like, yeah, it's kind of Iggy like, but like. In presence, it's different, and it hits differently.
Right. And that's why I hated the comparison, you know. But if you're going to be a front man, someone's always going to say something about Iggy. But, you know, I guess, I don't know. When I went to high school, I was listening to Steven Tyler and Aerosmith and Kiss and, you know, Frank Zappa. I mean, those were kind of my early things that I was listening to. So I don't know how I developed that character that I wanted to present or who it came from. But yeah, I saw all those bands, you know, Iggy was like my first big, even before the Pistols, Iggy was my punk rock experience, you know, the very first thing where, and, you know, I was really fortunate. I did that movie Mosquito, and I got to hang around with Ron Ashton the whole summer.
Yes, I've been meaning to bring that up, but it would have seemed like a really, really brutal interjection. But yeah, please tell me about Mosquito.
Well, it was just great because, you know, Gunnar Hansen from Leatherface I play his younger brother. And yeah. I went to movie drive-ins to see the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre with Gunnar in it. So you just think later on in life, I'm in a movie with Gunnar, you know, it's just, you never believe it. But the best thing was that Ron Ashton was also in the movie, and he's done several movies with this whole group of people. So he is very comfortable. And it was just great. We had a whole summer at this woods, out in the woods, because it's about giant 6-foot mosquitoes.
Yeah. It's from that grand tradition of like the monster movie as like, not meaning CGI, but like, no.
Just
like,
before this is, CGI. Yeah. Yeah. This just is before the green screen.
This is not just practical effects. This is the most practical of practical effects.
It's so good. And it is before all the CGI and all that stuff. So it's got that feel to it, like you said. But yeah, having Ron in there for the whole summer, I got to hear so many Iggy stories and just so much about that band. It was great. It was before Iggy took them back. Right. So Ron still had a lot of axe to grind.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and that's something where, you know, what a guitar player, like what an iconic and astounding guitar, like one of my favorites of all time, for sure.
I met him when he was in Dark Carnival, and he stayed at my house in Kalamazoo after a show, and I hung out with him in Dark Carnival a little bit, and but then when we did the movie together, I really got to know him, and he's a prankster. He loved pulling the old pranks. I can only imagine how terrible it must have been, kind of Iggy in a band with Ron and his brother, just on his ass the whole time. I mean, they must have just been just like, watch Iggy go, you know, and just encouraged him to be the most fucked up, do the most fucked up shit so they could just watch him and laugh. Those two brothers, Scott and Ron, like I said, at the movie set, Ron was always pulling some type of fucking prank, and he didn't have any respect for lead singers at all.
Well, you probably had something of an adversarial relationship at that point, right? I mean, it's sort of like,
we got along great. Just like, you're not, you know, you're a fucking singer. You're not a musician. You know, you're not, you know, it's what came first, the chicken or the egg type thing, you know, with the Stooges, you know.
I mean, it's like, it makes me sad that I've talked to James Williamson, and that was brilliant. That was great. But like, I wish I'd had the chance to like talk to Ron. I did get to see him play with, Jay Mascis and Mike Watt. And, like they dragged him out, and actually Scott McKay, came out too. And like, I was one of like three people in the audience that was like, oh my God. And everyone's like, who's that guy? I'm like, oh my God.
Right. Ron Ashton, man.
It's Ron fucking Ashton. Are you kidding me here?
He invented a guitar style that totally, you know, there would be no Sonic Youth. There would be, you know, absolutely anything without Ron for Right, yeah. And I can tell you a funny Ron story about the movie. At the end, everyone has their script book, you know, and everyone yeah. signs everyone else's script book. And okay. So the lead girl, a real cute girl, really lead actress, she hands out her script book for everybody to sign. So Ron signs it, and he draws a giant penis with hairy balls and pubic hair all over it, and then signs it Mike Hard. And gives it back to the girl. So the rest of the time, she thinks I'm this fucking pervert that signed her script book, you know, with a giant hairy penis, you know, spitting out cum. And Ron just sitting there, you know, that I could only imagine. I felt that's when I felt like Iggy. I did feel like Iggy yeah, at yeah. that point. Ron just sitting there with a big shit ass grin, knowing that, you know, this chick thinks I'm scum now. And she still to this day thinks I drew the cock on her script book.
Was Gunnar cool? Was he
that stuff cool the whole movie. I mean, something he'd call it make you drop a line.
was it Ranger Hendrix? Was that what is his character's name? Ron, I think, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, exactly. It's after his favorite guitars, yeah. After Jimi Hendrix, his favorite guitar player. Yeah, he was Ranger Hendrix, right? Yeah, what a fun time.
How was Gunnar Hansen a cool guy? Was he?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, a fantastic guy. Super. The gentle giant. And like every day we rode to set together. He stayed in the same town, so we'd ride the same car up together. And yeah, I got to hear all about Toby Hopper and how they did that movie and how, yeah. you know, they were pretty much locked out at that farm for like a month or 2 months straight. And it was a totally controlled environment. Everybody went nuts. He didn't make any money on it, you know, of course, you know, never got paid anything for it. And he came over and I would show some of the band's albums I'd have with his image on the front. Like there's
yeah.
a compilation from Chicago, something, and he's on it. And then there's a Anti-Scene 45 with him on the cover. And he just couldn't believe how his image was totally reused again by all these bands.
Well, it was very punk rock, right? It was something that was adopted by, because at the time, because there wasn't that type of movie around at the time. Like now I feel like it's more common. Yeah. Like I think everything's, you know, more common. But like,
oh my God,
there was nothing like that. That was the freakiest movie. It was, you know, it was like, oh my God.
And he said there's no blood in the movie. If you watch it, you don't, there's no blood in it at all. Besides, the only blood in the movie, I guess, is when the guy accidentally dropped a hammer on the guy's head in the bucket. That was an accident, and he did get blood from that, but that wasn't even supposed to happen in the first place. But it was interesting, and you could see how that movie was made, how intense it is. And I don't know if it was on purpose, but Toby created a very intense environment for them to work in, and it came out like that. But I saw that at a drive-in in high school. So,
yeah, you know. That's something that's going to change your world. I mean, like, the thing that gets me too is it's not like there's anything supernatural or like alien or anything happening. Oh. It's like anyone that's ever been on tour and has ever, like, you know, taken like a wrong turn down. Like,
I see that movie and I always think of Gibby and the Butthole Surfers. I think they did a short film similar to that. But every time I see Texas Chainsaw Massacre, I kind of think of that. This is like the Butthole Surfer stuff, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think that they would probably be honored by that comparison, I would say, to a certain degree.
Yeah.
they would not be bummed out by it.
Yeah, scary.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's you know, it provokes a reaction, but it comes at it from a way that freaks you the hell out.
Yeah, I watched the first Last House on the Left with my daughter. She's seen the new one that came out.
Oh, sure. Ago, whatever. Yeah.
And
yeah.
I said, oh, you never seen the first one. And I actually found it on a video, you know. So she could, the difference in those two movies are amazing. But the first one's still really intense, you know.
That's the rare example of when there's a remake that, like, you know, it's sort of like, oh, it isn't like, oh, they made this and it sucks. It's like, oh, no, it's a different kind of take. Almost.
Yeah.
This is gonna sound really A, pretentious, B, kind of niche, but it's like Sorcerer and Wages of Fear. That they're different movies that kind of like they do the same thing, but they it's approached from a different way. And it just occurs to me how little that actually happens. It's usually like, oh, there's this remake and it sucks, or like, oh, the original one wasn't good and like the remake's better or whatever. Right. And then in those cases, it kind of seemed like, oh, it's just the, this is the different take on this. And, you know, it, it hits slightly differently in certain ways because of it.
Right. Or just they can't write a good script anymore in Hollywood, so they keep doing these old ones over and over again.
Well, and there's plenty of great scripts being written. They just don't want to do it because they want they want their previously established commodity.
I tried to do a little acting, and I did a little bit of stuff because of Mosquito. It was cool. But, you know, I found out it sucked. I hated it. It was terrible. It was just like job. Mosquito. Yeah, because someone's telling you what to say. Well, someone's telling you what to say, what to do, how to do it. It was just like a job. And I'm like, give me back rock and roll. You know, give me, you know, let me write my own stuff and perform it. I don't like this being, you know, bossed around by a director thing. Didn't like it one bit.
Can you, so we alluded to it actually before we sort of blasted through all the records, but Kill the King, the one that Jello did on AT, I mean, that was the first one that there was, you included lyrics in it. There wasn't a bunch of like effects on the voice. You know, there's no, at least half of it, if I remember correctly, doesn't really have like a spoken word sample or anything. It's almost like there was different things going on in that record than before. Was there an idea of like, hey, let's try this for a bit? Or was it like a greater idea behind doing it in that way as opposed to what you've done in the other records?
Yeah, it was a totally different record from the get-go because Tommy was back playing guitar and not David. So what happened is I was working with the band Thrall, and Jello did a Thrall record, but he really wanted to do a Godbully record really, really bad.
Yeah.
And so when I did the Thrall stuff at that same studio, which is like 54 Sound, it's a really famous studio in Detroit. Eminem ended up working there later. And Joel Martin, the guy that produced the whole thing, was the publishing behind Eminem. So we got this chance to work in this killer studio that Funkadelic recorded in, Aretha Franklin recorded in, the Romantics all recorded there. So that was the first time, that's the first record that David didn't do on an 8-track. So right away, we're in this big Detroit, you know, famous studio. And we did the Thrall record there, and Joel Martin did it for the advance, which was pennies, you know, like a couple $1,000 from Jello. So he was super cool because really it was like a, you know, couple $1,000 an hour studio.
Right.
But anyway, so he just liked us. We got to do it. And so that from the get-go was a whole different arrangement. So I got the bands back together, but David was still living in Minneapolis. So, and Tommy was in Kalamazoo, and so was Mike Corso. So I said, Jello wants to do this record, you know, do you guys want to do something? So they all wanted to do something, and we started rehearsing it and getting it going. So the songs are more Tommy songs than David songs.
Okay, which makes sense. Which makes sense why it would hit differently.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
Oh, yeah. And you can tell because there's a lot more psychedelic, like, you know, 2+2, but Space Kid Zoom. David, the cool thing David did with that record is he mixed Hate, the song called Hate.
Yeah,
it's about a 8-minute song, and he mixed that like only David Livingstone could, and on this big huge board. And to me, I think it's a masterpiece how he just, the song diminishes into this wall of noise.
It starts out really
rhythmatically, and then it just turns into, you know, who motivates the motivator.
Right. Like it has a psychedelic,
you know,
psychedelic in such a way that it starts one place and like ends in another, like it very much another.
Yeah. Just a total collage of noise at the end. And that was David out. And that was what David did. I think he might have played a little bit of guitar on that song as well. But pretty much it was all done by Tommy, Mike Corso and Adam Berg. And in the big studio. So, yeah, it had a different sound because it was just, you know, really working with quality equipment. And not that we're working with David on the 8-track. Yeah, bumping all the drums down to one, you know, from 4 to 1 and, you know, all that stuff. It was just a nice, comfortable recording session. Yeah. But I think Kill the King, the song, King of Sling is one of my favorite songs. I love the lyrics in it. Yeah, it rolls right along. It's one of my favorite songs. Yeah, and same with Space Kids Zoom. It's just so psychedelic, you know. Hey, let's get blown away. Doesn't matter what people say. It's got the great line. It's like, we're going through the process to process our mind. Don't worry, we do this all the time.
Right. You got that assurance in there, you know.
Yeah.
So then, well, and there's also the artificial insemination.
Oh yeah, how right? about that one?
That's a good time too.
Once again, what a great
artificial insemination by aliens.
At the very end, it says, "I must acute." Yes, yeah, or jack off.
Yeah.
Which is pretty much the chorus in it. But I love the end. It says, "I must. You alone can prevent the second coming of Christ. I must have killed millions and millions of babies with my bare hands."
So
let's
then,
jack off. You know.
Right, right, right. Can you speak a little bit about Pretty on the Inside? That's a pretty interesting Whoa. Piece on that record.
Well, it was done with Karen Neal, who was the bass player in Thrall. And she was in a band, Inside Out and Lickety Clit and Queen Bee. So fantastic bass player, killer musician. And that is, I don't know if I, at the end I say Courtney. It was written after a conversation in Germany at a whole show in the back room where, do you want the full story?
Absolutely. Yes, please.
All right, so we're on tour in Germany, and we got like 3 or 4 days with Hole, right? And Courtney's in the back room, and there's this other guy who's smoking hash in a pipe, you know, and he's from Germany, and he hijacked a plane from East Germany to West Germany to be free, right? This is before the wall came down, when he did it. The wall was already down when this happened. So he's smoking hash with everyone and telling us the story how he hijacked a plane to be free, and he spent 7 years in a prison. So first Courtney comes over and asks him if he can get any smack, you know, and after he tells this beautiful story about freedom, it's like, so what, can you get me some smack?
Yeah. Yeah, great.
Yeah. Cool, dude. Right on. Wow. So he's like, no, darling, you don't need that. You know, hash is the gods, made by the gods. You know, it's, you know, grown naturally. That's a whole hash thing. Right. So she's like, ah, fuck you. He's like, keeps telling the story, and she goes, you know what I'd have done? You know what I'd have done if I was you? I'd have just fucking whored my way out. You know, like, if she was caught in the same situation, you know, hey, girls are girls, they can do what they want to do, whatever. I don't know. But, you know, it kind of put the guy down, like, she could just fuck her way out of the situation he was in. I mean, hijacking a plane, I can't condone, but it takes some balls to fucking hijack a guy to be free, you know? So I was kind of amazed by his story, and I was amazed by how stupid she was being to this guy, and how, saying how she would just whore her way out, you know? So it's funny because
it's insensitive at best. I mean,
yeah. So, you know, made me start thinking about, you know, how some girls are forced into this life where they have to whore their fucking way out, you know, of whatever they're doing, you know? And then they meet guys that, like the guy in the suit and tie, you know, I got a wife with kids, I got a family of my own. And she's saying, you know, I do this dope because I have to do the dope, because I got to fuck guys like you all day, you know? So, you know, she's telling, you know, you get high this way, I get high with this way, you use other people, I don't use other people use me. So in a way, I'm saying how some people, like, she was used, or they used, other people use different things and other things, but end up using
it's transactional system. Yeah, exactly.
So just her, just she made me think about that, saying I would just whore my way out, and just being how cold it was. And, you know, maybe this is what she had to do. You know, maybe she's been in situations like this where, fuck, that's how Courtney got out of the situation a couple times. You know, like, fuck, I could just whore my way out of it. And it's, I just felt, gosh, you know, what a desperate thing to do. And the mentality of it, you know, is really, really scary. And what you have to do to live with those decisions. But it's funny, after that, she was putting her makeup on, and Corso, Mike Corso, the bass player, is behind her, and she had her baby doll dress on, and she's got her ass right in my face and right in Corso's face, bent over in a makeup mirror, putting her makeup on. So Corso decides to light a Bic lighter underneath her ass. So, like, if she farts, it will, like, you know, catch on fire. And everyone's laughing in the dressing room. You know, they're laughing because Corso's got this Bic lighter up against her ass trying to see if she'll fart. And she thinks they're laughing at her, you know, because she's telling some story while she's putting her makeup on. So it didn't get as heavy, you know. It finally, everyone was laughing later on, and we were joking around together. But it got kind of intense there for a while with this guy saying, "I hijacked the fucking plane to be free," and she's like, "Ah, so what? I had to hoard my way out. We got any dope, you know?"
Yeah. That's great. Where's the heroin?
Yeah.
Compelling story. Yeah.
But we had, playing with them, we had a couple of shows where we had to play with them, and it was always a nightmare. So,
Patty, who plays drums in Hole, is she's top people, ace folks. I'm a big Patty Shamble fan. It's something where for me, and the reason why I brought that song up specifically is like listening to that song in 2021 versus like when it came out, it was like, oh, that hits kind of differently. Like it makes you think a bit like this is, because it feels like almost like a noirish tale almost.
Right. Well, yeah, right? It like is.
Here's this vignette that like happens like, you know, in the middle of this record. I'm like, you think it's going to go one place and it kind of goes there and it kind of goes another and it kind of turns around.
It moves back and forth really well. Right.
Yeah. And it ends up kind of landing on this, you know, for lack of a better term, more humanist mindset, where it's not like, you know, passing judgment, but like asking questions. But gosh, I mean, I can only imagine, you know, I guess now to a certain degree, like, you know, people don't want the nuance, they just want the reaction. But kind of, you know, bold inclusion.
Yeah, thank you. You know, and we played that in Ann Arbor on a review we did or something like that. And this guy named R. Wolf, who's been doing radio in Ann Arbor on a college music station for like 30 years, he was in the other room when they played that. And he came in and it's like, what was that? Oh my, you know, oh my God, that was so good. You know, I've never heard anything like that before, you know, and I'm like,
yeah.
It's just a story, you know. It's a story about people and, like you said, transactions we have to go through to get the next day. But it is, yeah. But you know, when you're in a band, you know, you do meet girls that you feel so sorry for, you know. You know, and I can't say that for all women or anything, but there's some, you know, especially with the punk rock and the grunge. There's kids that, you know, don't have, you know, divorced family. I came from a divorced family, but. You know what I mean? They have no direction and they get lost, and, you know, some guy offers some money for something and it seems to be an easy transaction, but the weight behind it is really, really heavy and you have to live with that. And same with the man who I was playing in the part I was playing in that. It's like, who does he think he is? You know, who the fuck does he think he is? You know, his life is better than hers. I mean, you're right. It moves around really well and you ask questions, which to me is what art it's all about, you know.
Well, yeah, it reminds me it reminds me of a, you know, it's very much like a Russian film or something along those lines, you know. In that sort of way, that sort of this bleak pragmatism that come forward from like this, like, yeah, this is the way it is, it'll never be better. And then like the sort of this like, oh well, no I don't know, oh well, gosh, I couldn't possibly, you know, kind of. And I don't, you know, it's cool. Like I dig it, but it's something that, like, you know, it's, I could see someone being less thoughtful to it, like only picking a couple pieces from it and being like, well, hey, they're anti-feminist because blah, blah, blah. And it's like, oh my God, you completely missed the point, didn't you?
Well, yeah, if you didn't live the life, or you don't know people that lived the life, or if you haven't put those shoes on yourself, then it's easy to judge. That's what we're going through right now, is that people don't wear other people's shoes. People don't have compassion for what other people go through to get to the next day. And so if we had a little bit more of that instead of judgment and just understanding, it's like, yeah, this is something that's going to happen. It's happening probably right now as we're speaking, some type of transaction like that where – you know, someone's having sex to get dope so they can have sex to get dope. It's like the band, I love the name of Cop Shoot Cop.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Well, right. And also I think of there's that Spaceman 3 record, what is it? Taking drugs to make music to take drugs to, if I remember, I think is the...
Yeah, it's like these vicious cycles and circles, you know, we go evolving. And that's, you know, being aware of that and being caught in them myself, it's all about breaking that cycle to, you know, step out of the circle. And I think that was kind of my mission, you know. It still is. I mean, David and I are trying to write stuff all the time. With the COVID, it's kind of hard, but we did a They Never Sleep record that I don't think anyone got to hear, and I think it's one of the best records I've ever done. Have you heard it?
No, I haven't. I've actually was going to ask you about that because I wanted to talk a little bit about Thrall, and I want to talk a little bit about They Never Sleep too. I feel like it's been very God Release heavy because that's, you know, a lot of people want to hear about that. But I think that it's, you know, it's something where when anytime someone's in an iconic band, like, it makes sense when someone only wants to talk about that iconic band, but also people continue to be creative. People continue to, I mean, Heroin Cheeks are hell of a band. It just happened to come after the cows. You know? Man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They're both fantastic bands. I mean, and Shannon's a good storyteller.
Fantastic. Like, one of the best. But yeah, so tell me, so why don't we start off with Thrall. Tell us how Thrall kind of came to pass.
And then Thrall came to pass because the God Bullies broke up. I decided I was gonna get married and have kids, and that you know, there's no way I could do that life and have this life. So I moved to Ann Arbor, and Scott Kodrick put up a sign because he found out from Johnny Brandon from Negative Approach and Laughing Hyenas that I lived in Ypsilanti. And so he said, and John's been to my house but didn't know where it was or something, but he knew that I walked to work down this certain road. So I'm walking to work, and on a telephone pole, I see Wanted, Mike Hart for punk rock underground metal band, you know, and
that's the most narrowcasted ad ever. I love it.
Yeah, we're getting a record deal. We got a record deal. We got managers. We got it all. You know, we just need a lead singer, you know. So I didn't call him for a while. And if I guess out of boredom or something, or someone said they knew him, or somehow I did eventually call Scott, and that started Thrall up. Just, you know, here I am, you know, about 10 years older than these guys. Johnny's here tonight, but these kids were all like 18, 19. I think I was just getting into my 30s. And we're rehearsing in their parents' house basement, you know, and it was just, you know, they wanted to do it really bad. They had stars in their eye. They thought by getting Mike Hard, it was their ticket to the big top or something, you know. But through Scott, I mean, he was a really hard worker, and we got all these connections to Detroit because I lived in Detroit now. So Straw became kind of like a Detroit band, and then I was able to get Karen Neal from Inside Out, who was one of my favorite bass players, and get her on stage with me. And we came out with Chemical Wedding, and you know, Jello put it out, and I think that's right up there with Kill the King and the rest of the God Bully stuff. The Chemical Wedding album is a great. I think it's good. The guitarist on there is Kevin Hagen, who passed away a couple years ago, and it's like the only album he's ever been on. So in the guitar playing, it's just fantastic. I mean, it's
ferocious.
Just
totally,
Yeah, he's just a great guitar player. So, and Karen's a great bass player, and you know, it's got you know, Mommy and Daddy Were Alien Gods, and it's got you know, some really good spoken word, like with lyrics like I don't need Dionne Warwick to see the future, and you know, I talks about like Orwell and Leary all being used by the government, and Jerry Garcia was secretly used by the CIA, you know, and just, you know, good conspiracy stuff, you know.
Back when conspiracy theories were fun and not
right. But
it occurs to me, like, you know, when Chemical Wedding, you know, that the like that last God Bully's record and Thrall, kind of like, it seems like there's some kind of crossover, some cross-pollination with a lot of those, like, sound.
Well, it was, they were both recorded in 54 Sound in Detroit, so they're both the same studio, same engineer, Steve King, and he worked on Aretha. I think he actually won a Grammy working with like Aretha or something. So,
oh wow,
yeah. Nice. He was the engineer, and they knew what they were doing, and it's got a really good big sound to it. And the worst thing is the drumming. Scott couldn't play drums. He could do everything else but play drums. And we had to do a lot of like rhythm hittings, you know, like, I don't know what they were doing. The engineer was doing it, but the bass playing and the guitar playing on it are fantastic. It just really rocks. It's a great album.
Well, and Thrall almost seems like it was doing doing raucous behavior, raucous songs, but without like some like the more heady intellectualism, not in a bad way, but in a way of like no, this is like, this is going to rock you. This is going to be like, yeah, the big rock band. And again, not to say that Godbillies don't rock, but like, you know, it's something where it kind of seems like there was a, from an outside perspective, at least, that Thrall could get a different kind of audience than what Godbillies did, just by nature of the compositions and by natures of, you know, it's too heavy to be like alternative and like too smart to be metal.
Yeah, it was a tough place to be in. Yeah. And it once again, it's because that's what the musicians gave me. I mean, Scott Kodrick, right, who wrote a lot of the songs on it, was way into Jesus Lizard and, you know, that kind of music. And some of the riffs, you know, I don't listen. I mean, some of the riffs, after listening to them, I think he stole them from other bands.
as long as it's a steal and not a borrow, that's the important thing.
Was it great musicians steal, good musicians
borrow? Is that what it is? Yeah,
it's something like that. But anyway, they were influenced by a little bit heavier music, him and Karen both. So, that, you know, that's where it took it, you know, just really heavy rock and band.
Well, and that that Hung Like God record, I mean, that's the one that is sort of like, oh wow, like it's almost like it was a little bit too early or a little bit too late, one or the other. But like that's a hell of a rock record. I mean,
That Hung Like God is great. That, I think, Johnny, are you on Hung Like God?
That's my first record.
Yeah. So, once again, two guitars, the big thing. That was you know, Warren DeFever from His Name Is Alive produced that. You know, we recorded that. So
nice.
Yeah. Once again, Night Fell is one of my favorite songs on there. Where are my people? Where are my people?
Yeah. And that's something again where I feel like there was that 2001 that one came out? That was that's 20 years ago. Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Still listen to today. Where are my people? You can hear it on the state capitol steps right now. Where right, are my exactly. people?
And again, like I firmly contend that was like a little too early or a little too late, right? Like, yeah. I feel like if that would have hit like 10 years later or like 10 years earlier, I think that would have
maybe I hit just a like the fact that you can put it on now and still get a vibe for it. You know what I mean? I mean, that's what's really, really cool about it. What we were saying earlier about music, like even if it's from 1970 or whatever, if you can put it on now and still get a feeling for it, man, that's beautiful.
That's absolutely. I think that counts for a lot. So can you talk a little bit about so you guys did Thrall did three records, right? There was the one that came out like on AT at the end, right? That was like AT at the beginning, and then Christopher put out the second one,
right? And Angelo put out Lifer, right?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and Lifer is now there's a lot of conspiracy stuff on that, which is kind of cool, right? Which I really like. Yeah. You know, it talks about, you know, everything from, you know, kids being stolen and turned into Sasquatches, and it goes through the whole Dan Brown the whole Catholic thing and the Templars.
The Opus Dei and all that.
Follow the path of initiation down the road of destruction, passed through generations in time, kept alive in your mother. Yeah, that was all that Dan Brown stuff was going on. But, you know, there's a book came out way before that called the Blood in the Chalice or the Chalice in the Blade. And pretty much talking about that whole bloodline of Christ, you know, which is still fascinating to me. Matter of fact, I hate to talk conspiracy, but the Templars just amazed me. The history of them and their secret religion and all that stuff. So, and at the time I think that's a little early, but So that was kind of on my mind a lot about this whole did Jesus live? I mean, did he live? And then I started thinking to myself, like, God, maybe Jesus lived for us. Maybe he didn't die for us. Maybe it's wrong. Maybe Jesus lived for us. And what a great thing that would be if Jesus lived for us instead of died for us. Like,
right.
Yeah, he actually lived for us, man. He didn't die for us. You know, I mean, kind of songwriting came out of that kind of whole mystical thing with Hung Like God. And course, the title is what better metal band title is that for?
It's pretty rock solid, yeah. Well, and it reminds me of, and I guess this is, you know, one of the times where I just make a statement rather than asking a question, but like when you're, because we've talked a lot about conspiracy theories and things along those lines. And it occurs to me that just because new metal bands, you know, decided to play their version of metal and it was awful doesn't mean that all metal is terrible. And in that same way, just because these new conspiracy theories are all total dog shit doesn't mean that all conspiracy theories are therefore invalidated.
Oh yeah, yeah. Like I said, there's really good ones. I mean, God, I mean, start with Kennedy. There's what, 400 books written on him being shot. Right. It's like a Ellery Queen or, you know, Nancy Drew shit. You know, I mean, yeah. Only somewhat true. Well, you know, depending how, like you said, how far down the rabbit hole you want to go.
Exactly. Well, that's the key, right? That's the key. Tell me? Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
I was just trying to say, like I said, this whole reptilian things and, you know, cannibals, and it's been around for a long time, but no one's really tied it into one total conspiracy with the Bilderbergers and the Templars and you know, the Freemasons and all that stuff. It's great, you know, how they are just able to make every conspiracy all into one.
And right, it's all just one big bouillabaisse.
Yeah. Exactly. And they believed it.
Well, it's, you know, it's very valuable to get people believing in a frame-based world if you can exploit it.
Right. You know, and that's what, these guys must feel so bad having their, you know, what, believing in a lie and just a hustler. You know, I don't know if you, yeah. I read a lot, especially with this whole COVID thing, I read a lot, and man, Donald Trump is the biggest money launderer in the world. He's all about the laundering of the money, and, he doesn't care if it's drug money, Russian money. He don't care whose money it is, but it's laundered through his apartments and how they
buy and
sell. Yeah. So these people that did this terrible thing don't realize he could give a fuck about you.
Well, so that's his greatest attribute.
What a con man.
Yeah. He's a combination snake oil salesman and a confidence man.
Right. Yeah.
And being able to combine those two and walk into a suit that was not in fact tailored for him, but fit him perfectly. You know, it's like, say what you want about the man, he's not an idiot. Like that guy figured something out that a lot of other people couldn't have, which is to say that he spotted rubes, you know, it was like, hey, cool, I can make this work for me. Right on.
Yeah, I don't know if he spotted him. I don't give him that much credit. I think they were spotted for him, and the rube that was spotted was him. I think he's been played this whole time like a piano. I really do.
Bit of column A, I think. I mean, it's but it me, is
what's coming down, you, I mean, fascism is, we got to watch out because it's coming down, and this is just a test. And these guys don't want to give up power, and they're not going to give up power easily. And as more people of color and more people of different cultures represent America, their power is going away, and they're going to hold on to it by hook or crook. And we're seeing that right now, and it's just going to get worse until it stops. You know, it doesn't get better until it gets worse. I really think that's happening. But, you know, once again, back to Thrall, that's what it's talking about right there. Icon, you know, that icon that you got sucked into believing, that's been lying to you your whole life. So it's kind of,
yeah, it's a running theme, right? Well, can you talk a little bit about the third record about Lifer? I mean, there's some, you know, we're going to get what we deserve. There's,
two people fuck, petrochemical, petrochemical pharmaceutical. I love that song. I think it's just so great. It's all, you know, once again, we're talking about simplicity of lyrics, you know, petrochemical, pharmaceutical, military industrial complex over and over again, you know,
until it loses meaning practically.
Oh man. But
are these words, am I saying words anymore?
Oh yeah. And it's huffing and puffing, and you know, that's kind of, you know, it's not anything more than what we've talked about earlier about what I've been writing about, but it's all right there in one sentence. And I it's like funny because the Metro Times and the Detroit, whatever, you know, like the Fan Time, they got kind of mad because I put their names in it. You know, it's because if you look in the back of them, they're just selling cigarettes and liquor and then all the all the strip bars, you know, and so they got all the bands in there and they're advertising for all this, but really all they're really selling is liquor, drugs, and, you know, and sex.
AKA the food groups, right?
And I say how they sold us out to the petrochemical, pharmaceutical, military industrial complex for these little trinkets of money. And so anyway, that's exactly what that song's about, you know, just.
Well, and we've talked about like evergreen topics, right? I mean, that's just as on point now as it was then.
I know. I love it. I love it. Yeah. Yeah. It's pretty cool that you can play that stuff and still see the, like I said, I don't think I'm an Nostradamus. I think that things haven't. The human mind hasn't changed that much. You know what I mean? It's the same. Right. It's just different tools we're learning to manipulate and are being manipulated against us.
Yeah, it's heady stuff, you know. So can we, you know, we're not going to be able to get to everything, but I do want to not give short shrift to They Never Sleep, because I feel like that's something that we should bring up, being somewhat timely and relevant.
You missed Brainsaw too, right?
I know. I was just gonna say, like, you know, I was like, oh,
man.
I was sitting there talking. All right, give me the briefest Brainsaw entry, only because we spent way too much time talking about Tobe Hooper and apparently Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Sorry, it's the show.
Brainsaw. All the songs were in D. That's all I really need to say. So everything's in D. We only put like about 5 songs out, but one's called I Hate Myself, which is I love it. The other one is the Vagrant, which is like my mother named me Michael after the Avenging Angel. In every drunken dive, in every filthy piss hole, I'm the, oh God, I can't even think of it. I'm gonna bring my church to the people.
Right.
So that's the Mike Hart story. You know, my mom named me Mike. So that song's just about, you know, being Mike Hart. And, you know, I Hate Myself is something we all go through sooner or later in life. And then you hate yourself because you hate everybody, basically.
Do you ever think about when when a band is, yeah, when you name a band, does the band ever inform the direction for where you go on stuff? Or is it just kind of like an empty canister to imbue meaning into?
No, Brainsaw was what the music was. I mean, we wanted it to sound
seven. It's evocative.
That hum, the saw like, makes when it hits your skull, you know. Oh, it's like that down in D hum, you know, that heavy, heavy hum. So that's what and we laughed about it when we made the title Brainsaw. But we wanted it to sound like the music, like every song's in D, super, super heavy and grinding. And then that was with Karen again, Johnny, and it was basically kind of a thrall, but in D, with a really, really good,
right?
With a really,
kept,
really
kept,
good,
kept the raucousness, but like added like a heavier, sure element by nature.
Yeah,
with the tuning. Yeah,
we had a great drummer too, and so yeah, it was that was a good band, and then we got back together with David, I, and Adam from God Bullies and did They Never Sleep with Karen from Thrall and Brainsaw. So it's really a good, I don't know if you can get it online, but I have a bunch of them here. I'll send you one if I can get your address.
I'd love to. I heard, somebody played me something. I can't even remember. And I dug it, but it occurred to me that it was like, I was like, oh, like I felt like it should be easier to find. But then by the same token, Mike, you also have the problem that when you search, so if you search for Conan Neutron, you'll find Conan O'Brien and you'll find Jimmy Neutron. Jimmy right. Neutron, by the way, which existed long after I started doing stuff, so fuck that character. Yeah, especially but with being Mike Hard, fucking, you have to almost eliminate Lemonade.
Yeah, isn't from the
search,
terrible?
Right.
Yeah,
I mean, what was that? Did you ever expect like?
I was like, no. I was Mike Hart before Mike Hard's Lemonade.
Yeah.
But my real name is Mike Hardback.
Right.
So Mike Hard just was shortened for that, you know, because
that's a great rock and roll name too. Yeah. You know, why not?
Yeah. But I was always called Hard in high school and stuff. Hard, you know, instead of Hardback, it was called Hard. So it's just like, yeah. So Mike Hard, right? So.
So I guess that was more like...
Oh, I'm sorry. I hate it too. My kids hate it. Everybody hates it, you know.
It's like even just having like a unique name, it's like, oh no, as long as there's an alcoholic malt beverage that's based upon a something that has a stand for. Forget it.
Can I sue him? You know,
yeah,
know.
You should.
Yeah.
At least get some free product out of it, right?
Right.
Well, but so okay, and Karen is not on all the They Never Sleep stuff. Like it's
no, she's all there. Yeah, yeah, it's all her.
So where can people, and because I feel like that's the band that's hardest to find of all the different bands. Like I'm old enough to remember MySpace. I'm old enough to remember there was a MySpace page. But yeah. I'm hard pressed to think if I've seen like a Bandcamp or anything along those lines. Is there places that people can find that?
I think David might have it for sale on Amazon.
Is it on Amazon? Okay. All right.
Yeah, I think so. You know, I have about that's what made me so mad. I was talking to David the other day. It's like, God, you know, I just hate this shit because, you know, I think the They Never Sleep was one of the best records they've ever made. It got nowhere, you know, and no one heard it. No one here wrote, you know, nothing.
Yeah.
So it just got really, really frustrating. So part of it's our fault. Or just, you know, we self-produced it, self-did it. So, you know, no distribution. That's the way it is, you know. We were selling it at our live shows.
Right. It's harder to... Like it, by the same token, it's easier to find everything, but it's harder to get new things out in the world and have it find its audience now. Yeah. And it, no, that's not anything to be like bummed out by about. It's just like, it's something to overcome. I think.
Yeah, right. So. Yeah. I would love to see like Jello or Haze, you know, say, yeah, I want to put that out, you know, cause there's only a couple hundred copies out of that, you know I mean? But you know, you never know. I don't know, you know, we'll see.
Can you talk a little bit about reconvening God Bullies when you did that, like what all that entailed and what kind of feelings that brought up?
Well, which time, like for the Haze thing or for the...
I was specifically thinking of the Hazelmeyer thing, but actually both times. So just again, knowing that you hadn't stopped, you've continued to, you know, do stuff, right? And then coming back to these songs and how do you approach them? Like, do you find it easy to get back into that mindset? Was it like, you know, putting on an old glove, or was it like, you know, take a little more work?
No, you know, it's like knowing the people that you've worked with, that you created with before, and knowing what they're going to bring to the table the next time. So once again, it was just like, you know, I really made sure David was involved with the Kill the King, because he was such an instrumental part of the first three records, even though Tommy was the very first guitarist, and he moved to New York and David took over. He was a young kid, you know, when we first started in Kalamazoo, and he just decided he wanted to get out of Kalamazoo. David was still going to school there, so he kind of moved into his part. And then when David started working for Peter Davis and living up in Minneapolis, he kind of stayed there for a while, and that's when the opportunity from Jello came to do it again and do a Godbully record. And David was just in Minneapolis, and that's simple as that. But I did get him to come down and actually start work on the engineering with it, so it could still kind of get that Livingstone feel and sound to it, because I think it's a big part of the God.
Well, I was gonna say, like, well, I'm glad you said that, because I feel like for whatever reason, we, you know, there's so much to talk about. We've covered so much stuff. Like, I feel like we haven't adequately expressed that. But like, it's a pretty big part of like what the God Bullies were.
David really. I mean, David got us to. In touch with Peter Davis and with maybe Hazelmeyer got us in Davis, but it got us in with that whole group of people, and he produced everything and he engineered everything, and you know, he was a big part of the sound. I mean, he was the sound. David was the God Bully sound, and I just he's so smart and so well read of a person that the fact that I got to be the lyricist and got to put my words to his music. I love it, man. I just think he's a really talented musician and engineer, and I'm glad I had a chance to work with him. And I'm just glad I have relationships with those people that I can keep going back, and that if something comes up, I can say, hey, you want to do this, or, you know, do you want to play like this? And David and I are still working together. We're trying to do anything we can to get something out again, you know? So.
But well, yeah, that, David, that's awesome to hear. I mean, because it's like... you know, going back to like the chemistry thing, you don't necessarily know all the constituent elements, but you always know when something causes a reaction, and you always know when like something's happening, right?
Yeah, you know.
And there's something special that happens with you guys, and I don't, you know, what is it? I don't know, but not to say that good things aren't, but it's nice to see.
I tried to do this Mike Hard thing for a while. It was just called Mike Hard, yeah. And it was with just a group of musicians, and we never wrote a thing. That just wasn't there. It was weird. They could play all the God Bless songs, and we could do all this They Never Sleep, God Bless Thrall medley or whatever, but we never wrote any songs, so we just didn't have that chemistry there. You know, the musicians could play all those songs. We could do the Mike Hart show just fine, but when we tried to rehearse, we just never wrote anything. It just wasn't there. But during that time, it was like doing They Never Sleep. And so, you know what I mean? It is what it is. You can feel that, like you were saying, it is that chemistry. It's like, I know what I get from David. I know what David brings to the table. And I can come up to meet his moods that he creates with the guitar and create stuff, you know?
And well, that's important. You know, that's exactly. That's something that, you know, even just being aware of that, it can kind of like, okay, I hate to do it, but I'm gonna bring it back to the Stooges and say that, like, as much as, you know, I love Iggy Pop, I love a lot of Iggy Pop solo stuff, but I mean, let's be real, Stooges are the Stooges, you know, and there was something just real special that happened when it's like you had Ron Ashton doing his, you know, open chord Montevideo orchestra guitar shit underneath here, and I'm glad that was realized, and there got to be like a whole new generation that got to see that. Because it doesn't mean that, you know, The Idiot isn't a brilliant record, you know, The Idiot's amazing. Like, you know, there's so much amazing stuff that like those guys have done, but it's sort of like, oh no, that's cool. It's nice to be at a level of an artist where you can acknowledge when something special happens and not have it take away from other things, to have it be like an additive.
And like you said, The Idiot is a great album, and you look at it and you look at how it was produced, and you know all the production that went behind that record. And I hate to say, that's the first Iggy Pop I ever bought was the Idiot, and from
Kelly. That's a good record.
I know. And after that, then I found more about the Stooges and stuff. And it's really weird living in Kalamazoo, Michigan, and going to the Wings Stadium to see Aerosmith and Kiss and ZZ Top. We never heard of fucking about Iggy Pop. Nothing. Yeah. He was like a Detroit dude, you know? And then you hear about him later. You listen to Idiot and like, oh, my God. And then you start getting in Raw Power. And you're like, oh, geez, you know, what did I miss? Because I was listening to Aerosmith and what was being fed down my throat. Not knowing just 90 miles away, there's fucking Iggy Pop and Ron Ashton and Scott Ashton.
Exactly.
You know, the Dum Dum Boys, you know?
Yeah, but that's the thing is that I feel like there's a constant through line with this show where I'm talking about, hey, things used to be different than they used to, but the idea that you would even be able to know about the Stooges back before, like, they came back, basically, because that was something where, like, a whole new generation was like, oh, this is awesome, and people that knew were like, yeah, we know.
Right.
Like I said, like, I was the guy that when Ron Ashton, like, went on stage with Jay Mascis and Mike Watt. They ripped through Three Stooges song. I was freaking out. My buddy had no idea. He's like, who's that dude?
Yeah, you know, and
and I'm like, one of the best guitar players of all time. Are you kidding me? Like, come on.
And believe me, you really didn't miss that much because in Detroit, the Iggy was literally like playing in front of 10 people at the ballroom. You know, I mean, he wasn't like packing them in or drawing anything at all. And he was always the opening act for years and years and years, you know. And when they got big, that was it. They imploded, you know. When they got to, you know, when they moved out to L.A. and thought that was going to change the world, oh, my God, hearing Ron Ashton's stories about them in L.A. with Iggy in L.A. was just hilarious, you know. I mean, it was the Dum Dum Boys. It really was. It was Iggy and the Dum Dum Boys, you know.
Well, and it's easy to look on things like that, like the rose-colored glasses. But then the whole, by the way, this isn't just a pointless story.
No, there's no rose-colored glasses, man. It was terrible. Ron hated it. Oh, my God. You know, he was disgusted. And they hated Iggy. They wanted to, you know, it was a messed up scene. Yeah.
So, but the reason why I'm going down with all this isn't just to be like, you know, continue my chairman of the Ron Ashton fan club, you know, motif, but also to say, like, going back to the Godbelly stuff and the fact that there's people that never got to see that band play like the first time, things along those lines. Was that something where like, did that, were you just holding the angle with it? Were you able to kind of appreciate the fact that like, hey, there's whole swaths of people that never got to see this band in its quote unquote heyday. And to have this other like pass at it, like that is that something that resonated with you at all?
No. It's back to the now.
Not so much. Huh?
It's the now. What we were talking about earlier. It's the now. Okay, you know, that was fine. Then. This is now. Yeah. I look back at the past and I just think it was fantastic and I can't replicate that. And I don't think necessarily like that, like especially when you listen to some of your earlier songs and, you know, you think differently now and you process things differently now. But I don't relive any of that stuff. I think when I get on stage now, it's I got this 45 minutes tonight with this band right here, right now in this room. And it's right. It's a whole different thing.
Well, I guess that's what I'm driving at because revisiting Godbelly's as a live band. And going back to those songs, you know, does it just snap back in? Are you looking at?
Well, it's you know what I mean. You know, well, I'm not going to get naked singing the songs anymore. You know, I mean, that's not going to happen. I've already, you know, realized it was just a dream, and I was in a room with naked with a bunch of people around me with their clothes on. But no. You bring you. It's the same story, but you find a different way to tell it, and probably better now. That I'm older and have told the story so many times, you know, so you find different ways to show it, to tell that same story. But, you know, I love using props, you know, the American flag is American flag.
Right.
Crosses it's are still, crosses. You know,
they're still going to these the yeah, same imagery yeah. is still going to have the same effect to a certain degree. Right. Like that hasn't changed.
I don't think so. Is anything worse? Right.
Well, and it's
way worse.
It has, but it just occurs to me that like some bands are very much like seem so ephemeral and of the time and like tied to a specific time and place. And I never got that impression with Godbelly's that like it always kind of seemed like it's always like a little out of time, right. A little bit timeless, and you know, for better or for worse. Like again, you're not gonna
exactly.
You know, hey, what am I gonna say? You're not gonna make millions stuff. You know, like that, what,
oh yeah. Well, when we saw Surgery get signed to a major label, we knew we were fucked. You know, I mean, we just like, you know,
that says a lot. I don't think
we weren't. Our ideas weren't mainstream. It does. But our thinking wasn't mainstream. It never was, and that's not why we were doing it. If anything, with David, it was that kind of to offend people a little bit, pushing there on their side. And I don't think I could ever be as offensive if David would want me to be, because he thinks there's no limits to giving back a little bit of what you've been taking for all these years.
Beautiful. So second to last thing is that Mike Greenless from Tar said that he ran into you at Disney World a few years back on Tom Sawyer Island.
Isn't that great? I was recognized at Disney World. I remind my son, who's an actor in New York, he's trying to be an actor, he lives in New York City. It's like, yeah, you know, I was recognized at Disney World, you know. It's like, I'm fucking cool.
Yeah. Don't forget that, Sonny.
That was a rock star moment. Now that was worth it all right there in front of the kids having, are you Mike Hard? You know, yeah. And like my kids all look at me, who's this guy, Dad? You know. But they discounted it a little bit because I played in a band, wasn't he? He wasn't a fan. He was played in a band. So
oh, it's another band guy. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. Like, oh, man. Didn't go up. Yeah. But that was great because he was with his kids just starting out. And my kids were all grown up. And so it got to see him, you know, they grow up so fast. They got to do the old Mike Hart preaching thing a little bit with him. And it's like, you know. This is the best time you'll ever have in your life, and they grow up so fast. So, you know, really enjoy it.
Take stock of it, enjoy it, et cetera.
That was a good thing. Yeah. My kids are all grown up now and living away. So.
Yeah, that's just a every once in a while something cool will come in from this being a live show, and that was something that I didn't know ahead of time, but I think that's very cool.
Oh, that's cool. You brought it up. Yeah. Yeah.
So last thing, and Mike, this has been great. Thanks so much for doing this, man. This has been great going.
Oh, thanks, Conan. Yeah, I appreciate it, man. And you're really doing a good thing, because like, people can't see this anymore. Like you said, live, they're not going to see this, but yet they're going to see what was behind it. And I think that's a good idea.
That's the idea. Right. and literally, like, I can't stress this enough. I only talk to people I'm interested in. And
thank you, man.
There's plenty of people they've turned down that I'm like, yeah, that's not for me.
Oh, thanks, Conan. Because I talked to Johnny, because Johnny follows you, and I'm kind of I just discovered YouTube last year. I hate to say it, so I'm just finding all this stuff out, and it's so cool. Right. But yeah, Johnny said something about it, and he said, "Yeah, his guests are. So he got L7, and he's got Hazelmeyer, and you know, he starts going down this list. I'm like, wow, oh, I'd love to do it. And then he said, you would be stoked. He goes, absolutely.
Overjoyed. Yeah. Like I said, anybody who can suggest something like this anytime, that if it's awesome, I'm going to say yes. And let's give all praise to Johnny for hooking it up and for forethought to bring it up.
Right on.
So the show, it's very off the cuff. It's ephemeral. It's a lot of things at once. It's very heady. It's very referential. But I have one canned question that I ask at the end of everything, and you can choose to interpret however you like. But the question is, why do you do what you do?
To get out of my body. Yeah, nice. That's it. Yeah.
That's good. I think it's the first time I've heard that. That's good. Mike, this has been a pleasure, sir.
Great. Thank you very much, Conan. And Johnny's like, he's a guitarist that was on that tour with us where we went up to, and he played with the God Bullies at the Hayes Festival thing. And, he's been, I wouldn't let the God... Yeah, I wouldn't let the God Bullies go on tour without him. So I put my foot down and said, no. Mike, you haven't played your bass in 15 years. I'm going to make sure I got a guy that is a musician that plays every day with us. So he fattened up the sound and made it sound fucking great. Yeah. So here's to Johnny.
Well, let's get it for Johnny. Mike, so much for being on the show, man. It's been a blast.
I appreciate it. Thank you for your time. Yep.
Yeah, until next time, brother.
You got it right on. Thanks.
Take care.
Yep.
Oh, there he goes, Mike Hard of the God Bullies and Thrall, and so many others. Good times, man. That was great. Hope you guys enjoyed that. We'll be right back.
All right. Sweet. So that was God Bullies. The fantastic, amazing, wonderful, pugnacious? Sure, pugnacious. God Bullies. That's enthrall. That was Mike Hard. Hey. Pride of Kalamazoo, man. Thanks, Johnny. Hey, hey, so the name of this show is Conan Neutron's Proton Reversal. Thank you so much for listening to it. Is this thing on? This show airs Thursdays, 8 Eastern, 7 Central, 6 Mountain, 5 Pacific on Radio Nope. RadioNope.com, say yes to Nope. ProtonicReversal.com for the archives. Always free, no ads, no sponsors, no kidding. If you like the show and you want to get episodes sooner, patreon.com/protonicreversal. $1 a month will get you there. Hey, big shout out also to folks reviewing the show and sharing it around. It's
signing off.
Means a lot.
Mr. and Mrs. America, all the ships at sea.
It's how people find out about it and how the show grows.
The sound of my voice.
So thank you for that. Some other cool stuff coming up.
I've got.
Stay tuned.
50,000 watts of power.
Thanks for all the nice comments, and the not so nice ones.
Wanna ionize the air.
No thanks to those ones, especially on YouTube. Let's hear your show. But.
This
thank
microphone.
You.
Sound into electricity.
And, you know, stay safe out there. It's a wild world.
Can you hear me now?
And take
out
it easy.
Route 128, the dark and lonely.
Take it easy.
Got my radio on. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Welcome to my top 10. I'd like to thank our sponsor. But we haven't got a sponsor. Not if you were the last man on earth. She was prepared to prove it. This one goes out to a special girl. There is no special girl! It's the end of radio! The last announcer plays the last record. The last what? Leaves the transmitter. Circles the globe in search of a listener.
Broadcasting if there's no one there to receive. It's the end of radio. As we come to the close of our broadcast day,
ready to rumble in earnest. I understand it probably just looks like I'm dicking around here, but I guarantee you I am not. That should be my prefacing statement for a lot of things in life. I understand it looks like I'm dicking around here, but I guarantee you I am not.
Hey, I learned in the Navy, always carry a clipboard around. You know, you look like you're important when you're...
Yeah, if you got a
clipboard and you'll think you're doing something.
Yeah, clearly he's doing something. He's got a clipboard. Why would you have a clipboard if you weren't doing something? I mean, clearly he's got something going on, right?
That's exactly good. That's what I learned. Yeah.